Loch Ness, Scotland. A place that for centuries has been home to one of the world's greatest mysteries. Some say a monster lurks beneath these waves. Others say it's a figment of vivid imaginations run wild in the imposing landscape of the Scottish Highlands. Now, these waters may finally tell the tale, thanks to the long-awaited results of cutting-edge science known as environmental DNA. If there is a monster in these waters, it cannot escape the building blocks of life. For more than a year, New Zealand professor Neil Gemmell and his team of scientists and researchers have mined the depths of Loch Ness, pulling hundreds of liters of water out and extracting DNA from the liquid. The results are in. Professor Gemmell can now say what creatures tested positive for being in the loch, and more importantly, what he didn't find.
Now we're going to tell you what we've found.
We find a lot of different species in Loch Ness. We find the salmon, we find the Arctic char, and a number of other species that we expected to find in Loch Ness. We also find evidence of a large number of terrestrial species. These are species that live in and around the loch. I wouldn't necessarily have thought of them as living in the loch, but they live near by the loch. And these include things like red deer and badgers, weasels, and a number of other species.
Neil knows the breathless question on everyone's mind is, what about the monster? First up, the theory that the Loch Ness Monster could be a giant catfish.
One popular explanation has been a giant catfish, so there's a species called the Wells catfish. It's found in Europe. It grows to 12, 15 feet in length. It's a very, very big animal, and pretty scary, I'd imagine, if it turned up next to your boat. We went looking for evidence of that sequence because the Victorians supposedly had put it into the loch about 100 years ago or so. And we didn't find any evidence of that giant catfish.
Next in the breach is the idea that the creature could be a giant sturgeon, a fish that can grow to enormous size, over 12 feet long.
And we did not find evidence of a giant sturgeon, which had been another popular idea that Adrian Shine and others had discussed.
Many Nessie hunters have always believed the monster is not a fish, but a massive dinosaur, a plesiosaur, which would fit the descriptions of thousands of eyewitness sightings.
There's obviously the Jurassic hypothesis, this notion that there is some sort of scaly reptilian creature, maybe a plesiosaur, that is stuck in Loch Ness, has been there for a long period of time.
There doesn't seem to be any plesiosaur DNA in Loch Ness. I'm really sorry for those of you who have the Nessie plushie toys that look like a plesiosaur.
There is nothing in the sequence that looks remotely like what we'd expect a plesiosaur or Jurassic Age reptile sequence to look like. A sequence like that should live somewhere in the tree of life between crocodiles and birds. Clearly these animals are extinct, but we can reconstruct what those sequences probably looked like. We don't find anything like that.
But Neil says there is something in Loch Ness that does fit the description of what many have seen.
We also explored this idea that maybe a giant eel explains the monster. And we do find an awful lot of eel DNA signal in our samples, distributed right throughout Loch Ness. So eel DNA is actually one of the more common hits that we get in our answer.
There's an idea that there may be these things called eunuch eels that never actually breed, and they just keep getting bigger and bigger. It's plausible that you can have eels that could grow to, I don't know, 6, 9, 12 feet in length.
And so perhaps this idea that there is a large eel of some shape or form people see from time to time, maybe that is one explanation. We at least can't discount at the moment.
Neil says about 25% of the samples remain unidentified.
The people who want to believe in the monster will go, well, Professor Gemmell, you moron. Clearly, that is where the monster lies and you haven't done your job properly. Well, if people want to go on their own adventure and explore these sequences, and I'm sure others will, all those data are going to be available alongside our scientific analysis of those, and people are entitled to make their own interpretations of those data and their own exploration of those data. And they may discover something that we have missed. That's entirely possible.
Without a definitive answer, those who have seen the monster and those who believe still think these dark depths hide a secret.
It's a characteristic of sightings that people are so clear in what they've seen. And if you were to try and say to them, well, that sounds like it could be a eel, they will laugh you out of the room.
In my view, eyewitnesses are honest and accurate in what they see.
I have a feeling it might go on to be a mystery for a long time yet.
Those people who say, well, it's still possible that Nessie is there, that it's a dinosaur or something from that age, they will say it hasn't been ruled out.
I stand out here on the decking outside my van on my own, and there's this energy that comes off the place. It feels like it comes out the top of my head in a column of white light. When I first arrived here, I used to feel that energy and think, well, that's because this is the home of one of the world's greatest mysteries.
We are the most interested in the things which seem imminently solvable, the things we're on the edge of discovery. That is how I account for the enduring popularity of the Loch Ness Monster.